Namaste. So, in our question and answer sessions, today I'm going to talk about form and formless. You see, these two terms, form and formless, are very pertinent. Pertinent in a sense, they become relative. So, we have to pass through a kind of relativity, you see. I will just try to take some examples initially, and then we will, go deeper and try to bring in some very good insights out of the discussion. You see, for example, take the example of ice, let us say. Ice has got a form. Now you, let's say you transform that ice into water, give some kind of temperature, the ice becomes water, right? Ice was like a stone, it was like a thick, perceivable structure. And then when it transforms into, let us say, water. Water also has a form, but water can take many forms. So you put in any container, it becomes that form. So now, in a relative way of speaking, now it is all relative. So comparatively, if you compare these two states, let us say, ice has got a form, then water becomes formless, relatively, if you compare both of them. And you further, let us say, you boil water and you steam it up. So when water becomes steam, now you compare these three states. We have ice at one hand, and then we have water, and then we have, let's say, steam. Okay, now you compare these three states. So what I'm saying in a relative way of speaking, I'm saying, compared to ice, water is formless. Okay? Compared to ice, water is formless. And the steam, compared to water, it is more steam formless. So we have to compare like this. And you know what? See, reality is like this. In order to know the existential, in order to know the ultimate reality, we have to pass through relativity. We have Albert Einstein's relativity at one hand. Then we have another reality. I will share it with you. We have to take it in a spiritual domain. See, why we are talking about form and the formless, what we are saying ultimately is that the Brahman is formless, colorless. Right? And attributeless. Why we are saying Brahman as Nirgun? Because it is beyond all gunas. We cannot conceive it as a concept. We cannot comprehend it through our mind. It will always remain para. It will always remain param. It will always remain beyond. And hence it is formless. It cannot come in the forms of our mind. No mathematical formula, it has no physics, it has no geometry. See, forget about all this. Even all our, let us say, stars, galaxies, they all, when let us say they go near to the black hole, what happens? The black hole gobbles all of them. So, what is the structure of the black hole? We have no idea, right? Even when we are talking about, let's say, matter and all kinds of matter, this so-called matter in the form of, let us say, stars, in the form of galaxies, in the form of planets, let us say, all that matter disappears into the black hole. So we really don't know what is the structure of the black hole, what happens there, why matter disappears, and when it disappears, what is the state, what really happens there, we have no information. So it's a far bigger paradox. a far bigger mystery of the existence. Right? So, on the path of spirituality, when we are talking about Brahman, we have to travel on the path of relativity. There is objective relativity and there is a subjective relativity. Why I am saying like this, like that? Let me try to explain. See, there is objective time and there is a subjective time. See, for example, what is objective time? Let's say I'm speaking and the video has begun at somewhere in the past and the video will end maybe 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 1 hour, 2 hour, like that. So there is that objective time that it started somewhere in the past and it will end somewhere in the future. Forget about all this. Today I am there. I have a birth date. When I go historically, see, I am timeless. You, me, we all are timeless. But then when it comes to the objective thing, this body is born. This came out of my mother's womb somewhere in the past and it started from, and somewhere I will not be there. Like many are not there. Even I too will not be there. So this is the objective time. The time that I am speaking now, this time will also pass. This is objective time. But the time is also subjective. When I say time is subjective, think about the time in your dreams. Think about the time in a dreamless state. Right? Like that, we have to go into various relativities. Objective relativity, where theory of relativity of Albert Einstein will govern, right? Because it is objective relativity. I have my own theory of consciousness. I have another theory called theory of consciousness, and I represent it by C is equal to Em square. Now, in theory of Albert Einstein's theory of relativity, what is happening there? There it is a matter and energy convertibility, interconvertibility of matter and energy, right? E is equal to mc square, where E is energy, m is mass, and when you multiply that mass with the velocity of light, then that mass gets converted into energy. All matter is energy and energy is matter. So one form of energy can get converted into another form of energy. We have all these are forms of energy: electrical energy, kinetic energy, potential energy, chemical energy, you take it nuclear energy. So all these are, there are various forms of energies, and it changes. One form of energy can convert into another form of energy. So that equation is talking about the mass energy equivalence, right? So what I am talking here is consciousness and energy equivalence. So C is consciousness, E is energy, but here I am talking about thought energy, right? Your mind is a factory of thoughts. So your thought is also matter. Thought is also energy, but it is so intangible that it is not tangible like they speak in science. It is not tangible like electrons and protons. Your thoughts are even more intangible, but thoughts are also matter, right? So how thought as an energy can be transformed into consciousness is what I'm talking about. So C is equal to Em square. Then you have to multiply it with mindfulness. This so-called mind, which is giving you a subjective relativity, it is creating a separate thought world, a mind universe. See, this mind is also a thought time object. It is creating a relative universe. It is creating a mind universe. So we have this universe. We don't know objective or subjective, how big, how small. We have no idea. Science has no idea. When we go into parallel universes, it is a multiverse kind of a thing. One string theory gives rise to 10 to the power 500 universes. Can you believe? So when we talk about parallel universes, there is one string theory. It talks about 10 to the power 500 universes. So what this whole universe is, how many universes, parallel or single, Big Bang or what, we have no idea. So there we are doing our research, we are doing, science is progressing slowly and slowly. So that is one dimension. We are calling it science. That is an objective dimension. But spirituality is not an objective dimension. It's a subjective dimension. It takes us in another dimension of relativity called subjective relativity. Then, you know, we are confronting with what is called a waking body and waking consciousness and waking time. Okay? And a dreaming body, dreaming consciousness and dreaming time. Just think about dreaming time. Let's say, take an example. You have, let us say, a novel. Let's say when you read this novel, it may take, let us say, I'm just saying hypothetically, let's say it takes 10 hours. To complete this novel, let us say you take 10 hours. Now, in film world, we know producers, directors, the whole of the team behind a film, these are special kind of people. They have a special talent. They convert that novel into a film. This film could be just hardly 1 hour or maximum 2 hours or 1.5 hours, like that. What happens? That whole of the novel, which you take, let us say, 10 hours to read and complete and to understand and to comprehend, they are completing that novel, that entire novel into a movie of, let us say, 1 hour or 1.5 hours. But they are giving you the whole message. So when you see the movie, it is almost like you have read and understood the novel. Now let us move into another subjectivity. Now think about your dreams. A 60-year story or a 50-year story or a 100-year story, you might just see that whole story in 1 minute dream or a half minute dream. Then just think what must be happening, what kind of time it is, how the time is moving in your dreams. So it is moving in a different way. There is a different relativity there. And just think in terms of, let us say, dreamless world. What happens? You almost don't know that there is time. That's why you are saying dreamless. So early in the morning, when you wake up and when you come to know, see, this is again a mystery. It was a dreamless night. You have not seen any dreams, and you feel a kind of nourishment. You feel a kind of healing kind of a thing when it comes to your body, because you had a dreamless sleep, and you come to know of this when you wake up. Then just think what must have happened to the time in that dreamless consciousness. So there is one body that is dreaming. There is another body that is experiencing dreamless state. And just think of this drugged state also. See, they are talking about altered state of consciousness in a drugged state. People are resorting to various drugs for an altered state of consciousness. I will never think of that, even allow that, because there are far bigger dangers of damaging your brain. Once your brain is damaged, you forget about all reality. All reality has gone. Your life has gone. So we have to be very careful when it comes to that drugged state of consciousness. So think of all these relative dimensions. So in the subjective relativity that I'm talking about, you have what is called waking consciousness, dreaming consciousness, dreamless consciousness, and this drugged consciousness. And there is another fourth, because earlier there was nothing like drugged consciousness, so that's why they have become fourth. Now let us say, without taking that, only if we talk about, let's say, dreaming consciousness, waking consciousness, and dreamless consciousness, there is something called fourth that the Mandukya Upanishad talks about. That fourth is also known as Turiya. So that fourth is a awakened consciousness. In that awakened consciousness, you experience Brahman, that is formless. It is existential. It is not part of any concepts or dogma. Everything that you read about, let's say, Brahman in books or Upanishads, they are just words. Just words. They will not help you. They are just concepts. They will not help you. So I just took those examples. Let us take a few more examples. Just think of a seed. Just think of a tree, let us say. Tree has got a form. Where from this tree has come? Just let us say, take the example. So the tree has come from a seed. Now this seed also has a form. From the seed has come the tree. Now you think of the flowers that come to the tree. The flowers also have got certain form. Now let us think of the fragrance. Now what is the form of the fragrance? It is formless. Just like we spoke about ice, water, and steam. In a similar way, I am taking another example. Seed, tree, flower, and fragrance. Fragrance. So, but then what will you do with this fragrance? Let us say, I'm just saying hypothetically, if you somehow, in some way, there is a method, let us say, scientific method, of collecting this fragrance and you are putting it in a test tube, in a lab, and you are preserving, let's say preserving, what use of that fragrance? That fragrance is there so that you feel it, you smell it. When you smell it, you know it. Are you getting my point? So that purpose, that fragrance is to smell it. Take another example. Let us say move from flower to fruit. Now the fruit has got a form. Now these flowers also are containing hundreds of potential seeds, which can, there is a potentiality, there is a probability, these can then become trees and then they flower. And again the flowers can contain hundreds of potential seeds. Right? So, in the same way, let us go little further. From flowers, let us say, move to fruit. Fruit also has got a form. Now what about the, now this fruit also has got a fragrance, but the fruit has got a kind of a taste. Take for example apple, orange, whatever. Now what is the purpose of this taste? Unless you eat it, you have to eat it to know it. So what I am saying is, you have to smell it to know it. You have to smell it to experience it. You have to eat it to experience it. You have to eat it to know it. That whole Brahman is like that. That formless Brahman, when we are talking about, you have to experience it. You have to transcend this subjective universe. I'm saying this thought time object, mind universe. We have to transcend this universe. So there I'm saying C is equal to EM square. So you have to multiply your mind with mindfulness. So M is a constant of meditation, constant of mindfulness. So we have to bring in that mindfulness so that thought energy converts into consciousness. It becomes your experience. Right? All that we are experiencing is a content in consciousness. And when you will experience yourself as you are, when the content goes away, when the thought goes away, when thought disappears, that's why Patanjali is saying, what he's saying? He's saying, Chitta Vritti Nirodha. What is yoga? Yoga will lead you to disappearance of thoughts. cessation of thoughts, cessation of vrittis. Chitta vritti nirodha. Is Patanjali Yoga is saying that. So the mind gets transformed into no mind. When I say no mind, now it is not a conditioned mind. It is an unconditioned mind. It is not going by the spin of the past. Right? So it is not going by memories. It is not going by past. It is not going also into imaginations. Patanjali is also talking about imaginations. The monkey mind is like that. So the monkey mind is, when I am talking about C is equal to EM squared, so the thoughts are going into past, the thoughts are going into future, and in a relative way, we are talking about the present. See, this present when we are talking about, even that is also part of time. So we are in a relative way saying that it is neither future nor past, but present we are saying. But present is also time. But when we are actually talking in terms of timelessness, here now, when we are talking about now, when we say in a spiritual way, when we say here now, that is transcending these three, that is transcending the mind, that is transcending the time. Now, just in a relative way, think of that experience. That experience is formless. Means, let me again take some example to make it clear. So we took the example of the fruit. So taste is formless. Compared to the fruit, compared to the seed, compared to the flower, compared to the tree, compared to the seed, all those that we talked about have got certain form. But what is the form of fragrance and what is the form of taste? They're formless. Now coming to my equation theory of, in the theory of consciousness, C is equal to EM squared. Now this consciousness is an experience. So this body has got a form. This mind has got a form. Your thought also has got a form, because it is part of matter. It is a matter. It has certain form because it is taking way, because it is bringing various concepts. It is going into imagination. It is going into past, into memories. It is in the present that we are talking now. So it is taking certain form. So it is part of the space-time object. So thought is a space-time object. So when he is saying chitta vritti nirodha, through mindfulness, that thought disappears. When there is no content in the consciousness, you experience yourself as you are. That is experiencing your true self. That the content is no more. Only the subject is. So the so-called srashta, the witnessing consciousness, and the so-called drashta, the creator, they both are in front of each other. Just like you are standing before a mirror. And then you are seeing your true self, which I am calling Sachitananda. That state is formless. That state is coming from your soul. It is a property of your soul. That state is coming from the Supreme. Now your soul is a subset of the Supreme. So in the C is equal to EM square, when you multiply your thoughts and all these states that I talked about, waking, dreaming, dreamless, will eventually give you that awakened state. And in that awakened state, you experience that Brahman, which is formless, attributeless. When you come out from there with that experience, you may be sharing with the world and you may be talking blah, 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 like I am talking. You may be using hundreds of words. You may be using sentences. You may be using concepts to explain. But those are just words. For the other person, it is just a relativity, unless that becomes his or her own true experience. So this is how the state of affairs when it comes to spirituality. So this is a short discussion when it comes to form and formless. Eventually, your soul has got no form because it is part of the Supreme. And soul is not matter. It is not energy. It is not force. It is nothing. It is no thing. That's why it is spiritual. You cannot measure it. You cannot experiment it. You have to experience it. There is no way. And the method is, I told you, method is only mindfulness. There is no other method. Yes, frameworks are there. You can go through Tantra. You can go through Sankhya. You can go through Vedanta. You can go through Yoga. Whichever that suits you, you can adopt. You can adopt Sankhya. You can adopt Yoga. You can adopt Tantra. You can adopt Vedanta. But one thing that will be common, as a common thread, any framework, what will be common? Chintan, Manan and Dhyan. These three will be common. Without that, there is no scope, there is no probability. So when that thought disappears, C is equal to EM squared, then this so-called monkey mind, the mind which is imagining, going into imaginations, going into past, into memories, living in the present, into so many things, this mind gets transformed into a silent mind. So negative mind, tamas, is getting transformed into positive mind called rajas, and then rajas mind is getting transformed into something called sattva, a balance. So it is getting transformed into a silent mind. So when you are arriving in a silent mind, you are living in akarma. So from karma, from the periphery of our body, then to the next layer called the mind, and then to the other next layer called emotions, then we are moving towards what I'm saying, silent, the silent mind. The probability of witnessing that reality increases. So in an absolute state of silence, there is a probability of getting in touch with that formless Brahman. So that is it for today in this discussion called form and formless. Be on this path, adopt mindfulness, adopt Chintan, Manan and Dhyan, move on that path courageously. There is nothing to worry about it. It all depends on you, but perseverance is required. So I spoke about you need karma. I said that meditation is all three things: doing, non-doing and being. And what are these states? What are these three layers when it comes to mindfulness? I said that we are doing karmas and then akarma and then to be that state, that formless Brahman, that experiencing that truth as it is. Where Buddha is saying tathata, suchness, to see the reality as it is without any dispersion, without any contradiction, without any contortion, to see it as it is. That state of yours is what is called Sachitananda. So a truthful, peaceful and blissful being. And that is sitting in each one of us. That is the potentiality. That is our potentiality. That's our possibility. So enough for today. It's almost, I think, 29 minutes, half an hour. So I'll stop it here today. When it comes to form and formless, I can only pray. Okay, let that happen to you too. So thank you so much for listening. And at the end, Tamsoma Jyotirgamaya. Thank you. Thank you so much.